Welcome to CNS Inspire series of interviews featuring conversations with people who have made commendable contribution over the years for development justice. Each interview of CNS Inspire series explores what went well and not so well in the past 10 to 20 years and how can we accelerate progress towards not only issue-specific goals and targets but also for integrated development for all. This CNS Inspire episode features a doctor who was the first amongst medical fraternity to begin caring for people living with HIV in Indian state of Kerala, a state called God's own land. Like everywhere else, three decades back, AIDS-related stigma and discrimination was raging high in God's own land too. But courageous decision and professional integrity of Dr. Sajith Kumar to step forward took him on a journey where AIDS care evolved over the past decades. Dr. R. Sajith Kumar is Professor and Head of Infectious Disease Department at Government Medical College and Hospital in Kottayam and former Joint Secretary of AIDS Society of India. Without any further delay, let's listen to what he shares with us on his journey spanning almost three decades in helping people stay alive with HIV.
We used to tell people there's practically nothing we can do for you. Now treatment is affordable, availability has increased a lot, accessibility has increased a lot. It was in 1991 that I was introduced to the national scenario of HIV/AIDS. Even though, from 1988 itself, our institution had problems related to HIV. It was in 91 that, NACO at that time, as part of their training program, aimed at training physicians on AIDS, selected a group of people like us, and we were submitted to training by the WHO directly, and then we were sent to three or four African countries like Zimbabwe, Uganda, Kenya, etc., where we had the first-hand experience of how this epidemic was hitting those countries and how the hospitals were getting adjusted to handling HIV/AIDS. That was way back in 1991 when India still considered HIV as a foreign disease. And perhaps in those days, I still remember, one of our first training programs was for doctors working in and around Kamathipura. That is the red street of Bombay of the erstwhile days. We had our first training inside Kamathipura training program for doctors. And subsequently, literally we went to all the states. Almost all the states in India, doctors were trained on HIV/AIDS. And 91 was the time when we used to tell people there is practically nothing we can do for you except that we'll treat your infections, except that there are a few tablets available which are going to be very expensive. I still remember those days, we used to give tablets like zidovudine alone for a cost of 5,500 rupees per month, and that used to be 5 capsules 2 times daily. That was the dose, which we used in those days. But subsequently, thanks to the interventions by NACO, WHO, UNAIDS, and so many, non-government organizations and social service organizations, and thanks to the active participation by the HIV-infected people, things have changed a lot. To say the least, now treatment is affordable even for people who are running auto rickshaw drivers, people who are working on part-time jobs, and availability has increased a lot, accessibility has increased a lot. But one point which we have to be careful is that, all those gains which we have obtained in the last two decades can be lost very easily. And now families have started accepting patients in their households. And over the last period of about 25 years, which I am talking about, we could see, newborn children growing up to adults. And I have a couple of young boys who have completed their engineering studies. A few of them are employed already. And they are reaching their 30s. So that's a pretty good experience, because those were the days when, we thought once HIV or AIDS means it's all gone forever. But now they are catching up, and cost has come down significantly. I still remember the days when, treatment used to be costing 25,000 rupees a month when my salary was only half of that. And now things have changed to such an extent that, you know, almost anybody can afford the treatment, and government has come up with reasonably good treatment at good quality. At least for the first 5-10 years, everything is fine now. Of course, we have problems when it comes to managing the patients on long term and managing certain specific categories of patients with complications. Well, number of patients are also coming down. So that, you know, we must be happy that some of our prevention efforts are also working. And particularly, you know, when I come from South, Kerala is one place where, you know, people are more educated, more literate, more health conscious, and accessibility to hospitals, treatments and doctors is much better than many other parts of the country. Things are changing a lot. And, you know, but one point which we have to be careful is that, you know, all those gains which we have obtained in the last 2 decades can be lost very easily unless we are still keen on those things. And the message should never go that HIV is nothing and, you know, it's something which we can manage that easily. And that preventive efforts should still continue. With those, you know, even the pre-exposure prophylaxis and all those things coming up, people get a feeling that, you know, it's just like any other disease, so why should you worry about this? No, no, you have to be worried about this. It's not a pleasant news to know that you are HIV infected, even now. And even in Western countries. And, you know, when I compare actually with Western countries, I find that the care that is given in India is reasonably good, except that we are lacking in some of those laboratory support which is quite standard in many countries. For example, the resistance studies, the susceptibility studies, and things like that have to improve definitely in our country also. And if we compare what has happened in many medical specialties like oncology or cardiology or neurology, I would say that science is still a little behind in HIV. We are still at a stage of empiric treatments in majority of instances. Diagnostic workups and interventions are not that critical and that sudden and that intensive as it is being done in other places. And all said and done, number of hospitals which care for HIV infection is also not that high compared to other places. You must be seeing the cardiac cath labs coming up in every village. But even now, HIV patients are being taken care of only in centralized situations. That has to change, and literally everybody must be able to manage these things. But scientific principles have to be followed. And even now, you know, proper and adequate therapy with good compliance is still a myth in India, I will say. Except in very few centers, the follow-up is not regular, particularly in private setup. And patients also take it lightly. That, you know, once they are all right, they start stopping their drugs. And the consequences are definitely going to be detrimental to the country as such, not only for the individuals. So those are some of the areas. And the other thing is training of young doctors, you know. Young doctors, for some reasons, you know, they don't show much interest in the field of HIV care. And in fact, we would like to have more of training given to these people so that they understand that there is a point in getting involved in HIV care. Right now, we find that the phases in HIV care is almost constant for the last many years. And that has to change. And just like we have the newer population of patients coming up, we must have newer population of doctors also replacing the senior people, perhaps. Not exactly replacing, but at least, you know, supporting them and ready to take over in the future. And all said and done, you know, whatever miracle is going to happen in HIV treatment as such, care has to be there at least for the next few decades. India will need a lot of people to take care of these patients. And, you know, strengthening of manpower is one area where there is some lacuna even now. Well, I feel that, you know, in the 1990s, we were all so afraid that we trained a large number of doctors at that stage. I still remember there were state level and district level training programs going on for doctors. And now, practically nothing is taking place in the field of training. That is one area where the government and as well as other NGOs should focus literally. Training not only for doctors, even for paramedics, even for ancillary staff, nursing staff, but their role in management of HIV is quite high. So training is one area where, you know, things have to improve definitely. of course, knowledge dissemination is not that big an issue these days because knowledge is no longer precious. Anybody can buy knowledge, and knowledge is so free now. But training is something different, you know, which has to be improved a lot. And the second, of course, is, you know, even now some of the drugs are still expensive. So drugs have to become a little more cheaper. And maybe that will make the lives of people a lot different. And now we are going to have people who have, you know, done well for 10 years, 20 years. And, you know, all on a sudden you cannot let them disappear from the scene. So we want more and more support to be given to the people who are already exposed to the various drugs and facing problems. So it's not that, you know, you start something for somebody and then after 5 years, 10 years, you say, you know, we are lost. And that should not be the situation. Once you start somebody on some drugs, you know, just like you have step one, step two, step three for hypertension. So here also you must have something to keep them alive as long as possible. So it's true that people are living longer. They're living better, but it has to be a little more organized and structured and systematic that has to happen. And once, you know, we are able to offer them, you know, regular viral load testing and resistance testing and all those things, I'm sure our country can do this. There's no doubt that we can do this, and we have enough manpower. Only thing is, it has to be structured, organized and trained properly. And that is perhaps the one that is going to be decided, left to be decided, you know. In the Western countries, perhaps things are better, but they have lesser number of people to handle and more money at their disposal. Well, we have to channelize. Channelization may be a better term for all these things. It's a proud moment to look back and reflect on what has happened, because we were able to help a lot of people who actually were denied any assistance by various sectors, you know. It's not only the health sector. Yeah, even the communities, even the families. And I have seen situations where, you know, the spouses have gone to the extent of abdicating their jobs, losing their opportunities to run away, to stay with patients, you know. And I've seen, you know, grandparents taking care of children where both parents of the children have been lost. And, you know, when somebody comes and tells me, you know, I recently had one boy coming to me. He was brought to me as a small kid in the hands of the grandparent when he was about maybe 3 days, 4 days old. And now he's switching his second job now after his graduation. And he's so happy, and he is now planning to do something for the next generation of youngsters coming up. It's quite gratifying also that, you know, we are not getting new children being infected because of the good antenatal screening and you know, treatment that we are giving for pregnant women. Newer children are not getting infected. That's another gratifying point, you know, because you know, when I talk to the pediatricians, they say they don't even see cases these days, and they're not. I mean, that we have reached that stage where pediatric AIDS is almost going to be eliminated in many parts of India. I don't say all of India, but many parts of India. Probably pediatric AIDS is going to be eliminated. Well, the other area is the other area of gratification is, you know, when we started treating people much earlier than before they became sick. I remember those days, you know, when I used to talk to the doctors itself. I used to give them, you know, at the end when they are going to die, we'll have something to keep them or prevent them from dying. But now that's not the situation. Even when they are healthy and absolutely normal, have something to prevent them from deteriorating. So we keep them at a higher level rather than, you know, just salvaging them from death. We are doing it much earlier, and we are offering a normal life to a large number of people. And these days we have lots of patients who are coming here and getting treatment from outside also, foreigners and even NRIs. And it's so gratifying when they say that, you know, they feel so comfortable being in the hands of Indian doctors rather than being treated by somebody in the US or Singapore or Malaysia or even Europe. So many patients who come back and get treatment regularly from Indian doctors, you know. So that's also gratifying in a sense. And the other gratifying point is when we compare with, you know, what they do in the other so-called life-saving specialties like cardiology and oncology and all. where they spend lakhs of rupees, and at the end of it, the results is not that good as we get in HIV medicine. Here, you know, you spend money and then you are rewarded. There's no doubt about that. It's much cheaper and to live the rest of the life. So the years saved is going to be much cheaper when you compare it with so many other interventions. Well, if we again bring a little more money, a little more orientation, a little more channelization, I think the field would still be happier. But you know, again, my request is that people of the younger generation should come up, and they should be ready to take care of these things. Well, the other point is that whatever we speak about HIV is applicable to a good number of many infectious diseases. You know, it's not just HIV alone, and that's why, you know, we in India, we are trying to maybe, you know, start infectious disease as a good specialty to which we want the youngsters to be attracted and involved. Well, let's hope for the best, and I'm sure the best is yet to come.
We were listening to Dr. R. Sajit Kumar, the very first doctor in Kerala who began caring for people living with HIV decades back. Dr. R. Sajit Kumar is Professor and Head of Infectious Diseases Department at Government Medical College and Hospital in Kottayam and former Joint Secretary of AIDS Society of India. This podcast episode is part of CNS Inspire series of interviews featuring conversations with people who have made commendable contribution over the years for development justice. Each interview of CNS Inspire series explores what went well and not so well in the past 10 to 3 years and how can we accelerate progress towards not only issue-specific goals and targets, but also for integrated development of all. For more details, be welcome to check out our website www.citizen-news.org. Thanks for listening and stay tuned for our next episode of CNS Inspire series. Goodbye.